Welcome back to another episode of Cigars and Cinema. Grab a cigar, something to pair it with, and let's journey into another episode of Smoke and Screen.
I can go slow ahead. Come on down and chump some of this.
You're gonna need a bigger boat. Of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world, she walks into mine.
Is that victory dance? Not until the fat lady sings.
The force is with you, young Skywalker.
I make it big, big, and give them 10% off. I make it 5%. I can't be done. Get out of here!
Today's episode of Cigars and Cinema is coming to you from the OGT Cigar Society. Enjoy a 5-pack of premium custom cigars each month at an undeniable price. Join the community and smoke with us on the Oakland Tobacconist YouTube channel as we delve into the rich experience of boutique and craft cigars and many cigars and vitolas custom made just for our membership. If you're interested and if you want to find out more about the subscription and a whole host of boutique cigars, visit us at www.oaklandtobacconist.com or find us on social media platforms like Instagram and TikTok at OGT Cigars. Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Cigar and Cinema Podcast Live, where we smoke cigars and unabashedly commentate and in some cases give extreme opinions on film and entertainment. As usual, I am one of your hosts, Eric Drazen from OGT Cigars, and along with me, the two other hosts, Curtis Bailey and Mike Coleman. Guys, how are you doing?
Doing well.
Awesome. I'm all right, except that I misplaced my gigantic American flag to put behind me. Sorry about that.
Looking a bit underdressed. Where's your helmet? Aren't you supposed to be wearing a helmet?
I probably should be. Smoking cigars is serious business.
I feel like at this point, what we need to do is we need to come up with like some like quote unquote super cool names on the introduction, like larger than life Coleman and like film buff Bailey.
Oh no.
why do I get the like Bill Murray movie that tanked? What are you trying to say about me, man?
Because you like Bill Murray, right?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, I don't. So that's why I don't get it. I feel like there's got to be a segment here. When I think of Cigars and Cinema Podcast, it's like, all right, well, for me, it's like, well, yeah, I'm this kind of the cigar guy on the show. Like, hey, here's the cigars. Here's some facts. This is what we're smoking. La, la, la. Curtis kind of has this like historian, like, did you know in 1942 the director was like,
did you know Curtis or Curtis, did you know Bailey?
I'll take that.
And then this. Coleman is kind of like, yeah, but what does the scene feel like? What is the mood? Yeah. How does this translate to the human condition? So I'm like, I think
I'm sorry that being existential comes so easy for me.
No, this is why it's good. There's several different pieces. So we've got three people out just saying hi. We've got JD, Pipes, and Dreams. Thank you guys for joining on again. I know you joined last week. Please light up something, enjoy it, and smoke with us. Also, we got the Josh on. Josh Keeney is on. All the way from
Josh. Hey, Josh. How's Josh, New York, man?
I think Josh is coming out to California next week, I believe.
Ooh, hey. Hey, yo. Yeah. There you go.
We've got Peter Bailey on. I'm not sure who that is. But...
What's up, brother?
And then we got Jack. Cheers. So thank you guys so much for joining on every week as we do Cigars and Cinema Podcast Live, choosing a new film. Josh texted me before this and was like, hey, if I gave you any like ideas for movies, what's the likelihood you might analyze it on the podcast? We're always highly up for suggestions.
Yeah.
Highly likely.
I completely followed that text up with like, it's pretty decent that we will, but absolutely no Tank Girl. Like I refuse.
Oh no.
That's pretty extreme considering that Evil Bong is technically still potentially on the docket somewhere.
Yeah. I was going to say, I think we're waiting for the right time. It'll hit. There'll be a point. Maybe for our 420 episode.
Yeah, exactly. There you go. JD Pipes in the Dream saying, burning a Davidoff signature, high roller. Very nice. Oh. Which brings us, cool. Of course, to what we are smoking. So,
yeah, I was about to say, what are we smoking?
If you guys are ever curious to smoke the same cigars we do, there's a way to achieve this at an extremely great price point. In fact, we're only down to two sampler packs left, and that is our official Cigars and Cinema podcast sample pack. So four cigars every month that are chosen that we will smoke live here on the show. This is an incredible pack, not only because it has some like higher dollar cigars, but also it's got that Year of the Smoky Lizard exclusive through the OGT Cigar Society. What we're smoking tonight out of this pack is a favorite of mine. I've smoked probably too many of them, and that is the Axum from Foundation Cigar Company. So don't get this wrong. This is like a new release, but it's not a new release. So the cigar was blended and created and released into the wild in 2023. However, it went through a rebranding. The original of the cigar was called the Mitapa, and then it was rebranded from Mitapa to Axum. The blend we are smoking tonight is a 5x50 Robusto soft box press. It features an Ecuadorian Sumatra wrapper, Connecticut broadleaf binder, and Nicaraguan filler. Now, the other thing that can get confusing with this blend is the label is the exact same on both blends. There is a Maduro version. There is a Claro version. The label is the exact same with no indication that there's a difference. So the only way to tell is by the tobacco like shade itself. Tonight, we are smoking the Claro. So, Robusto Claro. Curtis, I'm pretty sure you've smoked this. Coleman, have you smoked this cigar?
Nope. I don't believe I've smoked this one.
Sweet. First time. Jack is saying, such a great sampler, especially the Year of the Smoky Lizard. Heck yes. And
absolutely.
JD is saying, we would love to join and get your sampler pack. So, JD, what I will say now is we're actually going to be shipping out our next Society pack this weekend, as it were. Goes through this weekend. If you're not a member of the OGT Cigar Society, now is the time to join. You can get on like the groundbreaking as it's about to ship out. Fantastic pack coming to all of our members. Please, we welcome you to join the community. With that said, what say you? We give this cigar a cut and get a cold draw going.
Yeah.
So this cigar to me is very dangerous.
Explain that.
Because It's dangerous to me because it hits just the right flavor profile. Like, it's easily one of my favorite foundations, and it's a cigar that has enough body, enough strength, enough flavor, but it's not overbearing. I could like smoke two of these back to back, like start chain smoking them.
Oh wow, what is it that I'm tasting on this?
Hey. I don't know. I'm very grassy. Hey. Alfalfa.
Yeah, I think that's pretty fair.
Salted hay, I would agree. A little salty. Cool. Well, let's get this lit up now. I will also say this 5x50, they're notorious for having a great draw and great smoke output, what I love, but it also will burn probably a little quick, just a heads up for this show. Because we have a very small movie to get.
Unlike our movie.
So, with that said, guys, grab your cigar. Let's light up. Every cigar is smoked in thirds, first third, second, and final, just as every movie in three acts. As you light up, take the time to toast it, smell the room note, and experience the first notes as the tobacco comes alive. In the same way, movies follow a structure, the Aristotle structure, inciting incident, attack, crisis, climax, resolution. In this order, we will break down the cigar and we will break down the movie. All right. I'm almost there. Halfway through
my lighter. We definitely did not forget to grab the lighter.
Oh, well done.
Ooh, yes. Right out the bat. I enjoy the retro on the cigar so much. The right amount of spice and pepper and all that goodness, but not crazy.
Now, Eric, I feel like Claro is a term I haven't seen too regularly. I believe there's a Padron that will do a Maduro and a Claro, maybe on a few of their lines. I don't exactly remember, but I don't see that too frequently, so I don't have like a good kind of sense of how to wrap my head around what that means and what I expect from a Claro.
Okay, so yeah, you're right. Padron does, they do their Maduro, and then they call theirs the Natural.
And
I feel like the dual like Maduro Claro of Axum and the dual Maduro Claro of Olmec he's heavily influenced by Padron because Nick Melillo, the blender, has admitted as much that he's loved a Padron cigar so long. Kind of want to go in that vein. But Claro is actually not a tobacco varietal. It's actually like a shade grade. Like if you're sorting wrapper leaf, you'd be like, this is Claro. This is Colorado Claro. Like it's a color of shade on the tobacco itself. So to the best of my knowledge, and this is as far as my understanding takes me, is that Claro is a referral to, it's more of a natural wrapper. It's almost interchangeable. Or you could say it's Colorado Claro. It's like almost sun grown. But it's difficult because you could have a Claro that's not sun-grown. Sun-grown is a term that's used in the industry to be like, it's a bunch of different tobaccos that could be sun-grown, but it's grown in the sun. And it's not fermented to be a Maduro necessarily, unless you want to say sun-grown Maduro. So it's kind of the process and how it's basically the shade appears of the tobacco.
Awesome.
For like the Maduro has been fermented longer to darken up, bring out more sugars. So you'll have a flavor difference because the fermentation is different from the Claro. Right.
Well, right off the bat, I don't know about you, but I'm getting like kind of like a spicy, salty graham cracker.
Okay. Did you ever have those cinnamon graham crackers like as a kid?
Oh yeah. Those are the good ones.
Yeah, they were good. They were
specifically good. I remember the, what were they called? The little bears. There was like little bears.
Oh, Teddy Grahams.
Teddy Grahams, thank you. Mm-mm. And they would be cinnamon
honey Teddy Grahams.
Jack is chiming in on that Claro conversation saying, I know Claro to translate as bright or clear. It's clear how you came across.
All right.
Cool. Yeah, okay. Interesting. I'm getting that spice. I'm getting a little bit of like that graham cracker sweetness, but I'm also getting a decent amount of popcorn, like kettle, like the kernel that's not popped at the bottom of the bowl. You know, you're like, you're digging for more and then you start chewing on the kernel. That's what I'm getting right now.
Yeah. The one that's going to chip one of my teeth these days. Yeah. What about you, Cole? I know that flavor. No, I was actually, I'm more inclined towards that kind of, yeah. I want to call it like, it's not burnt popcorn, but it's, yeah, there's a, it's not open flavor. It's the kernel. Yeah. Okay. So I'm tasting that. Okay. The graham cracker, I'm not picking up so much on. I'm trying to find the graham cracker.
Well, and in defense of pretty much every tasting note that I give tonight, I just had a blackened rockfish for dinner. So my mouth got lit up by, I just used some Tony Chachere's seasoning on there and it's a little spicy.
Man, we should have went over to Curtis's house tonight for dinner. That was great. Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay. So with that said, tonight is Curtis's pick and this is the second installment out of three. Discussing films throughout time who have gotten Best Picture awarded. Curtis, this was your pick. What did you choose?
This is the Best Picture winner for the year 1970, and the film is Patton. Yeah.
With George C. Scott. Yeah, so this actually, I think, was Coleman and my first time watching this, right? Coleman, you haven't seen this before?
This was my first time watching it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So first, like, appearance. Now, Curtis, do you remember when you first watched this movie?
It was probably in the neighborhood of 15 years ago, give or take. I couldn't pin it down, but something to that effect. Actually that was the only time I'd seen it. But it left such an impression on me and loomed so large in my memory that like, it was an easy one to think of when we were getting into this conversation. Because I mean, there's lots of different styles of movies and lots of reasons to like, movies, but one of my favorite things that will always kind of be a winner is when there's really strong characters, you know, like Marge Gunderson from Fargo or Rick Blaine, or is it Blaine? What's his last name in Casablanca? At any rate, you know what I'm talking about. So, yeah. And for me, George S. Patton as presented in this film, regardless of how, you know, accurate is to the historical Patton, just if you take this guy as a character in a movie and as the subject of a character study, I think he's fascinating. So that's a big part of what kind of like always kept this movie rattling around in my noggin.
Okay. Okay. And I want to get into this and kind of get into like opinions of first time watching and such like that. So very quickly, let me rattle off a few facts here. Patton was made in 1970, rated PG. Ratings were different back then.
They were.
It is a runtime of 2 hours and 52 minutes. It is directed by Franklin J. Schaffner. And what I didn't realize until we were actually like watching it and the credits started coming up, I didn't know Coppola was one of the writers of this movie.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, crazy. Okay. And it stars, to name a few, George C. Scott, Carl Malden, Michael Strong, Stephen Young, to name some of the top four. Yeah, Coleman, what is your thoughts on Patton being the first time you watched it?
Oh, I get to lead it off. All right. It was a long movie.
I echo that.
I have to say my walk away from it is I actually enjoyed it. I don't know if I liked it, but I enjoyed it. It was an experience. Same with Curtis. I think the character dive of it made it very interesting for me, but I appreciated the way they didn't just paint him one way. Like they did give him a little bit of a dimension, you know, which was nice. And because I was afraid it was just going to be, I'm this type of person and that's it. And it's like, oh, okay. But it was like, I felt like they did a decent job of showing a little bit more. So that was good. It's just, it's hard because isn't this technically a like biograph or like a biopic or whatever?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I feel like biopics are just kind of tougher on the story front.
Mm.
It's because it much more is just about the characters. So I feel like it was enjoyable. It was enjoyable is what I will say.
Interesting enough.
My diplomatic answer.
Interesting enough. JD is saying, I own a CB radio shop and the old man, George, who taught me how to work on radios, used to be one of Patton's radio men in World War II. That's really cool.
That is cool.
That is a small world right there.
Yeah. Whoa. That's nuts.
That's cool.
Mike, you don't have to moderate your opinion for this podcast, though. I believe it's in the in the intro that we sometimes give extreme opinions.
It's
extreme.
The hard part about this is there's multiple sides to it for me, and I don't know how deep I want to go into because one of them is like just for a little bit of a slice of life backstory. I have a very vivid memory of my grandma, who was a very stern woman. That's the word we'll use. I remember she said, she was like, you know, kids should be treated like the way Patton wanted them treated. Like that had no context for me until today, and now I'm like, this explains so much about you, grandma.
So
lovely lady, but yeah. So see, that's why I was giving a diplomatic answer.
Okay. I'm also edging on the side of diplomatic. I don't want to piss off anyone or make anyone mad. I feel like I pissed off enough people with my assessment of Tombstone and Forrest Gump. And again, I want to
warranted.
Yeah, I think it is. But I want to go into this with the statement of this is my opinion, not fact. My opinion. It was a very
disclaimer tough, flashing across the screen.
It was extremely tough for me to get through this movie.
Really?
Yes. And I'm hoping, this is my honest hope. I don't want to rant about not liking this movie. I feel like I'm missing something here. And when I watched it, I felt like I was missing something because I'm not coming from a background of like, it's got to be action all the time. Like we've got to have explosions and Saving Private Ryan Normandy all the time. Like, there's a lot of classic World War II movies like Stalag 17 or Great Escape that are technically slow depictions of World War II, but I absolutely love them. So
I would not call this a World War II movie.
But it takes place during that time. The backdrop.
I know, but it's not a World War II movie.
But
I think I'd agree with Mike on that.
Like, so, a World War II movie is like midway. And, you know, I don't know. It's like, those are like World War II movies. This is a character study. This isn't really.
It's kind of like Darkest Hour. Did you see Darkest Hour with Winston Churchill? I mean,
Gary Oldman. I did not. I want
great
to.
Movie. Great movie.
With Winston Churchill.
Yeah. With him as Winston Churchill.
That's how good of a job Gary Oldman did.
Yeah, he's great. He smoked so many cigars during making that movie that he got nicotine sick. Like he meth.
Yeah, well, yeah.
So anyways, that takes place during World War II. I think the same argument could be made. It's not a World War II movie. But what I'm saying is that the spectacle of this is during World War II.
Yeah.
And there's the conflict takes place there. So I think I was about 37 minutes in and I turned to Mallory and I was like, what? Like I was lost. I was like, where? And then I started to realize, okay, so this, now correct me if I'm wrong, Curtis, this, yeah. Most of the story kind of like revolves around this concept of Patton is kind of this like out of touch with current times, kind of like the old soldier who is trying to continue in his path as an old soldier, but has to navigate that in a changing world, basically.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that they mention a few times in the film that he's sort of an anachronism, you know, a man uniquely suited to the pursuit of warfare and demonstrates that. I mean, Patton in real life never lost a battle, you know. He was a remarkably effective battlefield commander. But that came with a lot of, you know, provisos, as it were. You know,
I want the truth.
Yeah,
he can't handle the truth.
He could be monstrously domineering. He was incredibly arrogant. He had zany ass ideas about like reincarnation, mm-hmm. and was also a man that, you know, was kind of lost and far afield outside of, you know, doing war stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, and was also kind of weirdly stuck in this position of having just enough self-awareness to recognize a degree of who he was and the contradiction there, but not enough to be able to do anything about it. And yeah. I don't know. I think that makes for a really fascinating character portrait.
So I'll give the caveat that I think George C. Scott did a really good job.
He's great
actor. It kind of felt like the way the movie was shot. Like there were scenes, like when we're seeing the theater of war or when we're seeing like them driving across the sunset and stuff like that, I was like, wow, this is a really beautifully shot scene. And then we get to moments of conversation that I'm like, this is as flat as we can film it. And it almost felt like there's a duality going on with it that left me a little confused. Mm-hmm. But again, I want this discussion not to be about me being like, I didn't really enjoy it. I want to understand it a bit more, if that makes sense.
No, I understand that. Sure. Yeah.
So like, what would you say, Curtis, in terms of like this film, because you've probably done more research about it, like about its production and such like that. Do you feel like it was pretty monumental for 1970? Like it was a very pivotal time or?
Go. Mike is raising his finger. What's up, dude?
Really quick, before you say something, I do want to ask a quick question. This was 1970, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Correct me if I'm wrong. This is like Cold War.
Cold War, and also, I mean, part of the answer that I was going to give to Eric just now is that.
That's what I wanted to say. I was like, this felt like a Cold War type film. Like,
well, but even more pointedly for me is that it came out in the midst of the Vietnam War. Especially when war was, you know, starting to become particularly unpopular. So to release a big 3-hour epic war/character movie in 1970, when war movies were kind of difficult to market, was a bold move on behalf of the filmmakers. But they believe so much in this story. And like I said, that it's really just, you know, this kind of like big, massive character portrait. That they went ahead and made it. And it could be even argued that, you know, releasing it at that time and thinking about what contemporary audiences would have been thinking about and feeling about this movie makes it even more complex because there are scenes with Patton that are utterly triumphant and ones where you're just like, this guy should have been kicked out of the army a year ago, you know? You know, those two things coexist at the same time, and putting that up in front of a Vietnam era audience is kind of a ballsy thing to do.
Now, here's a question. This is where it kind of confused me in the beginning. So we hear his speech in the beginning, you get an idea of like, okay, this is where Patton's coming from and his ideology. And then he gets transported to like the first area where he takes over command. And you get the sense of like, okay, he's going to run a tight ship. And he's a brilliant strategist and all these things. And then two planes come in and bomb the place. And he jumps out the window and starts firing with a handgun. And I'm like, now, is this to demonstrate that he's just nuts or emotional? Or like, I didn't understand that, where that was.
It's a man who is so in love with his own legend that he'll just do stupid shit because he knows that's what he's supposed to do. Like, that's what I saw. When he was like, that's enough. You know, this is it. Like, I'm tired of this shit. Like, it's like he just knows. It's kind of like the John Wayne character of like, they're just so larger than life that you're like, they're not real, right?
Yeah.
It's like, no, they're out there. They're people that have their own legend, you know.
He's the kind of character too for whom you know, standing up forthrightly like that to the enemy and being willing to take him on himself rather than, you know, hiding behind the safety of a wall or, you know, a group of men or whatever, you know, I mean, that was just the kind of like weirdly
romanticized,
proud, arrogant warrior poet type dude that he thought he was.
I think the thing that's confusing to me, though, is not the fact that he's willing to do that, but that he would do it so stupidly, like, childlike, to where he would reprimand probably any one of his soldiers who did it, because he's like, well, what the hell are you doing? So I'm like, that's where I'm like, but yeah, but the method that he chooses to do makes no sense to me. Like, I'm like, is he just an idiot? Like, I don't understand that. It still confuses me because it's like, I understand the ideology, I understand what's trying to be conveyed, but at the same time, like,
that's I mean, I understand having difficulty wrapping your head around that. But
that's kind of the point, though, I think.
He is a bizarre character. But yeah, Patton is, to some degree, a walking contradiction.
Right. Okay.
So the fact that it doesn't make sense on any terms that you can evaluate for, like, you know, if I were in that situation, or if I even imagined somebody slightly different than me in that situation, what's the sensible thing to do? And that's not how Patton looks at it.
Right.
Okay. Okay.
And I feel like that is just, I think, really hammered home in the scene. And I know I'm skipping way ahead here, but I feel like it's kind of like a repeat thing that happens throughout the movie. But you have that scene where he's, you know, in the hallway and he's walking away going, I'm like done. I'm ruined. And then he's like, no. Like, I did not come to this point and have all this thing. He's like, no, it's God's will. This is what's happening. I will see a battle. Like, I will like fulfill my thing. And it's like, that is not the normal thing that people would have walking away from that type of meeting. You know, it's like, that's, people don't go, this is God's will. I'm going to get into battle. It's like most other people be like, well, I guess I'm done. I'm going home.
You know? Sure.
And he just kept going forward. Like, that's the thing, is you couldn't stop him. So that's kind of, I think that's the whole thing. Is it doesn't have to make sense for him. It's just you have to be going forward.
Okay. Well, and kind of on that tail end, JD is saying Patton was stopped by the government. He was going to go after Russia as well. I mean, yeah, like endlessly go. Now, what do you think his main story arc? Like, it's hard to do so in a biopic, but it's like, what do you feel like the film is trying to convey? Is it more of just to give a sense of who Patton was? Was it a way to be like, show his point of view, or I mean, what do you guys think on that?
My take on it is that Patton is demonstrated to be a man who is tragically kind of out of step with the time that he lives in, and also his own worst enemy. So,
okay,
you know, there's this sort of duality of the thing that makes him great serves him great in one particularly narrow, very narrow kind of avenue of life, and is kind of ruinous practically everywhere else. And, you know, even if the version of himself that he imagines lived in the past and stuff is, you know, ultimately unrealistic and a fantasy, it's nevertheless something that really motivates him and he identifies highly with, and that makes him, I don't know, almost comic in a way, you know, that he has such grandiose ideas about himself. And he's a, this is, you know, a grown ass adult man who has fantasies of having been famous past warriors. And it's just, I don't know. I think that Patton is an endlessly complicated and fascinating character that even gets more complicated the more that you think about him, at least as presented in this movie.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Is there a comment?
Peter Bailey, saying, remember, he thinks he's reincarnated. In his mind, shooting at a bomber isn't stupid, it's romantic. How else can you go 1v1 with a pilot? There's a Don Quixote quality in his mentality, which, of course, even the
Nazis compare
it to that too as well. I don't know.
Eric is too practical. That is stupid. That is the fastest way to get killed.
No, it's not that. It's not about like putting yourself in harm's way. It's like we've all seen those movies. I mean, we talked about True Grit, and it's like, yeah, he's going up against three different guys and stuff like that. But it's like, I don't know. I mean, it makes sense what you guys are saying. It's just difficult for me. But Coleman, what were you going to say?
No, I was just kind of echoing Curtis's sentiments and thoughts. Just it is one of those things where he is a person born in the wrong century, you know, like, and that's why I think it's so easy for someone like him to fully believe that he's reincarnated. It's like, it's just so has taken over his mind. But yeah, you're in the era of propaganda. And so it's like, your mouth is going to get you in such trouble, you know, but I think that's also kind of a fun thing that they played with. I don't know any of the historical accuracy. So, you know, feel free to put down what actually happened or what was actually covert ops or, you know, intel. But as presented in the film, it's like his big mouth actually ended up helping also, even though it also caused a bunch of harm, because by having such a big mouth and charismatic personality and going on this little tour, you know, while they're like, you're on probation, it's like he was still helped by convincing the Nazis that, hey, no, he's going down there, that's where they're gonna invade. Yeah. And they pulled away, you know, a huge chunk of their troops.
That is something that happened in real life after the incident with the slap, which I'm sure we'll talk about more later. Army did intentionally use Patton as a decoy because of his reputation.
It's like, it's one of those things where it's like, kind of how, you know, it's kind of like gunpowder. It's like, it can be entertaining, it could also be really dangerous, it can also be really destructive, you know. It's you can use it a lot of different ways. So I think that's kind of the way that this movie tries to portray him, is that it's like, he is who he is, and for better or worse, you know, and it's kind of like, just point him in the right direction, you know, because he's just going to keep going with who he is and what he's doing.
Right. Now, really quickly, yeah, we'll get into the slap and such like that, but I also want to jump into the second third while the second third still exists in this cigar.
Yeah, so, I was going to say, it is what is going fast for me. Sorry.
I'm trying to pace myself.
Yeah, likewise. Ash is holding on really good. Burn is like razor sharp. I find this cigar very consistent. It's very full in flavor. Yep. It's one of those ones that just like, it's everywhere when you're smoking it, which is great. It's very immersive. I don't notice crazy changes on transitions. What about you guys?
Yeah, as is common with a lot of smokes, you know, the degree of like maybe heat or pepperiness that I tasted on the light up has mellowed since. Otherwise, I wouldn't report any significant changes other than just saying, damn, this is really good.
Yeah, exactly. It's just solid and consistent. What about you, Coleman?
It's extremely consistent. I feel like it stayed the same the whole time. And yeah. It's almost weird. there, do you get like a weird kind of almost like chlorine pool kind of burn in your retro?
I haven't noticed that.
Not necessarily. No?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting.
For dinner.
soup, potato soup.
All right.
That's very good, actually. But it was really good. But no, I don't know. It's
like that when you've been swimming for too long in a swimming pool.
Yeah, it's not like a bad thing, but it's more like, yeah, when you've been swimming too long, or you know, you did a cannonball and it went up your nose a couple hours ago, and so you kind of have that residual kind of you know, I don't know. I'm getting that on the retro.
Okay.
Which is interesting.
I'm still getting that pretty prominent, like popcorny kennel corn like type flavor.
Oh yeah, no, I'm sorry, I don't want people to think that chlorine is like a dominant flavor. It's not. It's on the very end of the retro. It's
the dominant flavor is definitely popcorn. It's arsenic, right? Arsenic.
Yeah. Cyanide. Yeah.
I do have to say I'm pairing it tonight with Green Spot, that's pretty damn nice together.
Nice.
Because they're really well balanced against each other. We have that situation sometimes where you get a whiskey that either flavor-wise or strength-wise is too strong for the cigar.
Yeah.
Or sometimes the other way around. These feel like they're just like right there next to each other. So
when I feel like when we did the pairing at the shop with the Bloody Knuckle Uppercut and that Balcones, it worked, but it was definitely on the edge of the Balcones being too hot.
I would agree.
Yeah. But there's also so much like sweetness from that single malt and then from the cigar itself. It almost was dessert like. So yeah, it's cool when you notice those changes. So here's something with the movie. Let's discuss the faded slap scene. And as far as you guys know, is that pretty accurate to how it happened? Like he actually went into a field hospital and did that?
Yeah, I think in real life, there were two separate incidents that happened relatively close together. But the manner in which they occurred is, as far as I understand, pretty similar to what's depicted in the movie.
Okay. Yeah. I would say it's very on character. Like it didn't shock me at all. I was like, oh, okay. He's slapping around. Where I think the thing that's funny is we've talked about this before about something like Fight Club. When that movie came out, when people watched it, there was like, oh, I see what kind of the commentary is going on here. And then there was the other group of people that were like, heck yeah, let's start our own Fight Club. And then let's have our under, like, let's this like bolster up. I kind of feel like there's a temptation with the movie, a Patton, for people to be like, see, that's how it's done. And there's like a train of jumping on that. And I don't know what you guys feel about that. I mean, Coleman's grandmother, apparently, yes.
Right.
my grandma had one of those little, you know, riding crops. She had one of those.
Oh, there you go.
she was extra.
She had a map of Yucaipa. She's like, if we drive down here.
Grand Terrace. Yeah, no. But yeah.
Yeah, so there's always that side of it. And I would be curious to know like how it impacted at the time it was. And you're right, Curtis. It is a very bold move for... I'm not only so surprised that like that much money was poured into a movie at that time to depict that, but also that it won Best Picture. That's really interesting to me. Yeah. Like,
I think because they didn't praise... Oh, go ahead.
No, please go ahead.
I was going to say, I think it's because they don't praise Patton for doing it. I think they just kind of show that he was a general. And it's like, and that's like, to be a general, that's kind of how extreme you have to be. But I think it was showing that everyone around him knew he was wrong. And so everyone around him told him he was wrong. And I think, I'm assuming they depicted it accurately. He apologized. He followed orders. You know, seems like it's not like he changed who he was. You know, it's still one of those things where I don't know. I think it kind of shows how if you don't keep up with the times, you can see why something was praised at one point. You know, because you could imagine, you know, back in the day when it was life or death. every day, you know, you didn't know if you're gonna have food, water, whatever, someone who'd freak out and shut down. It's like, hey, that's dead weight, that's danger, you know, it's like, that's bad, get rid of it. Now we don't have that, you know, or at least, you know, where we live. And so we see that as obviously like, hey, wait a second, something else is going on here, let's, you know, look at it. So it just kind of shows that at a time that was, you know, needed, but now we know better. And I think if you pull in the Vietnam kind of commentary, there was a lot of that too, of just people coming home very shaken by what they see, what they saw, what they did, you know. And it's kind of showing, and it's like kind of show a mercy hand to those people rather than being like, suck it up. So it's like, I feel like that's kind of more the intention of that, is to show, kind of have a softer hand with those who are suffering, even though they didn't get wounded.
Okay. Well, yeah. And to that effect, there's two comments here. Very quickly, Jack says, cheers, I have to cut. Can't wait to get into that axum I have. Thanks for joining us tonight, Jack.
Great stick, Jack.
Great stick. I actually got a little bit of coffee on that last one. Coffee sweetness. And then Peter Bailey is saying he didn't believe in shell shock. The slapping incidents, there were two, actually led to the decay operation Curtis mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
So there you go.
One of the things I love about that scene is that the slapping incident comes immediately on the heels of Patton very solemnly and without any whiff of apparent insincerity, kneels at the bedside of another wounded serviceman and puts his Purple Heart on his pillow and seemingly says a little prayer to himself. And the contrast of those two things in one scene, like, that clicks for me. I love that in movies.
Well, and I feel like it kind of shows on Patton's character how to basically get his respect, what makes him respect one person over the other.
Oh yeah. Like when he kisses that guy on the forehead, when he talks about how they were fighting hand to hand by the time dawn came around, like that's, like, I find that kind of scene. This is what I love about this movie, is that it makes me feel multiple emotions at the same time. Mm-hmm. Like when he gives that guy a kiss on his head after hearing the story of the battle, I'm both kind of like feel admiration for him and chilled at the same time.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, and do you think that's all at all like connected with the slap in terms of like him kind of seeing another side to someone who's kind of out of it? Or do you feel like that kind of fits into that Purple Heart patient?
More the latter, I would say. You know, I mean, Patton, you know, definitely sees battle as the noblest of pursuits. You know, had he been Nordic, he would be a believer in Valhalla, which I don't know how much you guys know about Norse mythology, but Valhalla is specifically the afterlife reserved for people who die valorously in battle. You don't go there, and you don't get there any other way.
Well, you also have to spray paint your teeth with chrome, right?
Well, exactly. Yeah.
Witness me.
So, but, and the only reason that I would like thought those were a little bit connected is there's a conversation he has earlier on between the slap and between that of him saying, if I had the chance again, I would have kissed him instead of slapped him.
Oh,
and
yeah.
We see that happen. So I was like, are they drawing a parallel here? But maybe not. I don't
know. I think that he's more reflecting out there on his kind of selfish desire to be a battlefield commander all the time. And had he known that this one thing would have taken him off of the chessboard, like even though, you know, reprimanding that prisoner was obviously important to him in the moment, it doesn't maybe matter to him as much as just commanding an army. And when they took that away from him, he felt the sting and was like, you know, I wish I'd kissed the son of a bitch or whatever. So
I was gonna say, I didn't take that as him changing, like, I don't think he would have done it any differently. I think what he was reflecting on is, had I known the cost, I would have never done it. You know, like, it's more like his punishment was too much to bear.
Yeah. But that's, you know, that's Patton's, I don't know, Achilles heel or whatever you want to call it, is that that he doesn't understand the political consequences of operating as he does in the real world, where there's accountability and, you know, a public watching. Like, in his head, those things don't compute until somebody is like, hey, dummy, by the way.
Yeah, sure. Well, okay, well,
and so, that's...
No, go ahead. Go ahead, Coleman.
All I was going to say is I couldn't help but think of Jack Nicholson's character in A Few Good Men as being almost like a direct inspiration of that character is Patton, where it's like you get these guys who it's like their life is war and battle. And it's like it's hard to pull them out of that and have them be this dynamic, you know, piece. Because that's the thing is, generals are a figurehead of, you know, something. So it's being great in battle, perfect, this is wonderful, but it's like you are destroying our political relationships and that is way more important in this day and age, you know.
Yeah.
And he just kind of, you can tell he had that old kind of romantic idea of we are going to battle and we are going to conquer everything, you know. He's like, we leave too soon. Just finish conquering it. We'll have to come back anyways. You know, it's like, dang, dude, that's pretty intense. Like, but, well, you know, that's what made him who he was.
I've got a question, Eric, for you that I've been kind of itching to talk about with this movie, because in a lot of our conversations about what we think works and doesn't work in films comes down to the quality of the dialogue. And I really like the way this movie is written. I love the kind of, again, almost contradictory nature of some of the comments. Like there's a scene where they're by the roadside and somebody questions Patton about the Bible. And, you know, does
every goddamn day.
And he says every goddamn day. And just the, and you almost don't even really, I mean, maybe he's saying that specifically because he wants to, you know, like poke those guys a little bit with a stick. But at the same time, I feel like he would say that to anybody that, so yeah, he's this man who has this ideology that at least in his head is driven by, you know, sort of providence from God, but then, you know, will say something like something that allegedly maybe even almost blasphemous, like, yeah, I read the Bible every goddamn day. And I love the dialogue in this movie. I think Patton has a lot of lines that are just indelible. Like, you know, Rommel, you magnificent bastard, I read your book. It's great. So, but that's me. I was wondering, like, did you take anything away from like a lot of Patton's lines in this? Or,
well, the dialogue is very pointed. Out of the things that I felt like kind of were sluggish or lacking, I didn't really necessarily find the dialogue to be, it's very colorful. But kind of like that struggle I was having with, as I mentioned, how it's filmed, it almost felt to me, and this is of course from just me watching it, but I kind of felt like it was almost filmed by two different people or two different inspirations, depending on, like, we had a director of cinematography for combat and we had one for dialogue and conversation. There's a lot of that kind of in even the characters. I mean, there's that line, sure, but there's also the fact that he believes in reincarnation, which is not really a biblical standpoint at all. So no. there are throughout that. And like I said, George C. Scott's depiction, he does a really good job. I especially enjoyed the transitions of him, like at the end when he's across the table with the Russians and he calls him a son of a bitch.
Yeah.
And then the Russian calls him back. And the smile he had, like that kind of like, you don't know if he's going to strike him or smile. And he smiles. Like, those types of things are really interesting to me. But oddly enough, where I think that the scene that I was like, okay, what is this reminding me of? Because there's something I can't really put a finger on. And we kind of talked about like the soldier who's kind of like time has passed and it's moving times. He's out of touch. And he walks up to talk to all the soldiers to give his apology. And the way he walks and the way he walks away, I was like, this really, really feels like a John Wayne movie. Like to me, in terms of the spectacle side, like the way he's sauntering, the way he's carrying himself, the concept alone is that old cowboy that's out of touch, that can't really, I mean, I've seen it in multiple Western films. And then I was like thinking, you know, I bet you anything, John Wayne was one of the cast, like, was potentials for this role. And I looked it up, and sure enough, he denied the role. I don't know why, but he was a potential. And it just had a lot of that going on. So while the dialogue, I believe, is very pointed, I feel like some of it's just, to me, a little clunky in terms of the rest of the narrative. Kind of like Montgomery, when we first see him, like, he comes into the bathroom and talks, and I'm like, is this a character of an English guy? Because, like, his upswing. I've never met anyone English. I'm not saying I've met a lot of people from England, but, like, I'm just like, this seems like a character. And then there's the scene where he blows into the camera. I was like, oh, that was interesting. Like, that was a really interesting shot. And then we go back to, like, a very interesting, like, 10 minutes. So it's just, to me, I was, like, being pulled into this, like, interesting conversation dialogue, but it's really laborious at the same time. And so, I don't know. It was...
Well, the one thing I'll say that partly in your defense there, and this is something that I notice a lot with movies kind of from this period of time, you know, maybe, like, late 50s through mid-70s, kind of roughly, is that there will be some things with scene construction and the pacing as you progress from one scene to another that doesn't feel the way that a modern movie would do it.
Sure.
It's not necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes I just have to, like, you know, put myself in a different mode. I'm like, all right, I'm not watching a modern movie. I'm watching a movie that was made 50 something years ago. And expectations and the standards or even, like, the advancement of the art form were not at the point where they are now, and in some cases good, some cases not good, but I think I understand what you're getting at as far as, you know, going moment to moment in this movie. Sometimes there might be transitions that feel like what we're moving into doesn't feel like it naturally flows from what preceded,
and that kind of— and true. I mean, I've seen many films from the earlier time, and you see the progression of, like, what changed, like that particular shot when Montgomery blows into the camera. To me, I'm like, that was probably one of the earliest times something like that was executed.
Could be.
It seems really early on. I hadn't seen it in earlier films, but I think, it was a little disorienting to me, I think, throughout the movie. And there's just a lot of, like, I don't know, rules maybe that weren't there at the time. Like, I've heard before, like, you know, if you're entering into a room and this is the first time you see this character on set and in front of the camera, you don't yawn or sigh into it because it automatically downgrades the intensity for the audience. There's, like, micro inflections like that. And I just felt like this was kind of, like, overrun by stuff like that. Like, even him lighting, like, smoking a cigar, you don't ever see him light the cigar. There's, like, no action behind it. It's just kind of like, well, this is a stage prop that you have. And again, these are very minor problems.
No, I get you, though.
But I'm just thinking of ways to, like, spice up those moments. That, yes, it's seven dudes at a table talking. Like, how do we make this more engaging, I guess?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, to think about the way that, like, you know, someone like Tarantino might film something similar where your main character, before he goes on a walk and talk with some people in a hallway to kind of, like, highlight his self-invested nature or whatever, you might do a 3 to 5 shot sequence, including close-ups of the cigar being lit and him kind of, you know, and so I understand what you mean by stuff like that being treated matter-of-factly when it could have been emphasized even more as a character moment. I just think that wasn't in the filmmaking lexicon in 1970. Yeah,
and I agree with that. I agree with that. I think it just, it made me feel two hours and 52 minutes of it.
No, I that's fair. It's fair.
Yeah, I just, sorry, go ahead.
Really, really, really quick, while we were just talking about the fact that Patton was a cigar smoker, I watched the making of documentary on my Blu-ray last night, and Franklin Schaffner, the director, pretty much every photo of him on set behind the camera directing this movie, he's got a cigar.
Oh, nice. So there you go.
Director of Patton, big cigar guy.
That's cool. That's cool. Coleman, what were you going to say?
Mike, yeah.
It's gone. It's gone to the nether.
I'm sorry.
We'll come back to
no, it's okay, all good. So, it was, what were we talking about before that?
About the laborious scenes that kind of
like the way you might.
Yeah. All I was gonna say is, whenever I start, like, because I know what you're talking about, how that stuff can distract you when you're watching a movie. I tend to just remind myself, if I feel like there's not enough action happening, I ask myself, is this in the era of where this was really a play on a, you know, movie screen rather than in a theater? And like, this is one of those movies where I felt that a lot, where I'm like, this is a play in a movie, you know, format. Like, it's, so I, that's how I just kind of try and check that off, as like, I'm not going to critique that part of it. Cause
right.
Yeah, it's not, you know, you're not going to get, I don't know, what's a, like a Blair Witch Project for in the 70s.
Right. And, okay, so like, maybe
it's not a thing yet.
Maybe I can articulate it better. So I feel like, especially even movies, if you take a look at, let's say, Casablanca and old classic films that have our dialogue heavy, there's enough animation and liveliness either happening in the background or happening within the characters, because at that point, the characters have to become the entertainment beyond that point. Like on a stage play, when you're dealing with heavy dialogue, then you have to create stage action to basically fill in those gaps. Now, we are talking about 1970, so it is earlier on, but at the same time, we are about a little over 40 years into filmmaking. I feel like the energy that is brought to those scenes kind of make you feel the lull in the action behind it. Now, there's a lot of subtlety. I'm not saying it's bad acting, but I'm saying when you're dealing with that type of subtlety, then I feel like, especially like Godfather was made, what, 2 years later?
I believe so.
Very different in conversations that are happening. Very different, engaging. We have the beginning scene of Godfather.
That's fair.
The man talking, like talking to Don, and the camera's pulling out. There's action going on. So Patton, to me, missed the mark, and that's why I feel like I was like, man, this keeps going. Like, if that makes sense.
No, that I putting it into perspective, saying that Godfather was made 2 years later. Yeah, they didn't make that much advancement in 2 years. Like, that's right. Okay. That's fair. So I guess it is just more of a style choice.
Sure. But and it is different than Tarantino. So I agree with that point, Curtis, for sure. But
yeah, Schaffner's shooting style is relatively objective.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's not a whole lot of particularly subjective things going on. I mean, you maybe point to some small parts where, like, you know, there's a shot where recently after a battle, Patton is sitting there in a Jeep, kind of, you know, contemplative or maybe even feeling proud as all these wounded soldiers that are wounded because of him are walking past the Jeep, you know.
Yeah. There's
a few moments like that, but like, it's not a movie where the intent was for the camera to be expressive. It's not quite shot like a play, but more to that end than the other.
and I think the confusing part to me is like when he shoots the two donkeys on the bridge, greatly done, well executed. The pull out, like far way back, and you just see the bodies like fall. I was like, wow, that's interesting. So those are the moments I'm like, no, it's there, but I just don't know why it's not there, I guess. Yeah. But
I think also that is probably a difference. I feel like all the scenes that you're pointing out that you liked were all outdoor shots. And I feel like everything that you're complaining about are all probably studio shots.
The Montgomery the Montgomery mirror thing is inside of a lavatory. So there are some inside, or even like the pop-up base that the general has that Patton goes to meet. I was like, okay, this is pretty imaginative how they have like the long to show the seclusion and how hot it is in there. I'm like, that works. But we are reaching towards the end of the cigar here. Curtis, are there certain things you want to discuss and talk about before we like reel it in?
I guess the last thing I want to comment on is how much I love the ending of the movie, particularly if you contrast it against the beginning where he's so large and proud and full of bravado, and the end, he relates that story about, you know, brilliant warriors in the Roman Empire getting what's called a triumph, which is basically just a huge parade where they celebrate you and make you awesome. But this is a true fact from history that there would often be a slave or someone similar standing behind the celebrated person, you know, whispering to them about how they're not that special. And the very last line of the movie is, you know, not all glory lives forever. And, you know, that's Patton getting maybe a sliver of self-awareness, but it also makes him tragic. But also maybe he kind of deserves it. And, you know, like it's just as complicated and interesting as I think as the rest of the movie is.
Okay.
And it makes me think of Ozymandias too, which I'm not a poetry guy. I could probably name 5 poems in the entire world, but my favorite one is Ozymandias, which is about this idea of greatness being fleeting. So I love the ending of this movie.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just to kind of touch on that real quick, I think that's why, like, what kept me so intrigued in this movie, you know, like, even though it was slow in the pacing, his character and how it expressed in all these different scenes and scenarios and over the course of time, it is one of those things where, like, I feel like when he's going down and shaking everyone's hands, I feel like that's him kind of realizing that it's like he needs everyone else in order to be great. You know, like, he's not great on his own. He's great because he inspires greatness. But it also, you know, can also not be a great thing. You know? Yeah. Because if that's the only way you're great, then as soon as you're not doing it, you know. So it's kind of, it is interesting.
This one guy, Peter Bailey, says, I was literally going to invoke Ozymandias. So you guys are on the same plane.
My brother.
No, and I will say I enjoyed the artistic choice difference when you see, like how you were saying, when he's grandiose in the beginning, and they choose to show this medal, that medal, his helmet, the star. Yeah. And then when he leaves, he's got this very plain beige, like, overcoat that covers
and everything. He's this big in the frame at the end. He's walking away.
So see, there was a lot of camera choices there that work.
You just wanted more.
Okay, so as we kind of come to the end here, I'm on the final third, about 2 inches left on this axum. How's it finishing off for you guys? What do you think?
I think that I'm picking up more of that popcorn character that you guys were talking about. And maybe it's because, like, I'm, you know, now 90 minutes away from my super spicy fish dinner that I had.
Okay.
But there's a certain kind of like starchy sweetness kind of thing that has popped in, if that makes sense. And you could kind of label that in the popcorn or maybe kettle corn kind of realm of things.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I need to try this one more time to have an honest opinion on it, because you guys have been, like, on fire for this thing, and I don't know, I just feel like it's been just kind of stable or standard, you know, like, I don't know. I
now know like how Curtis feels about me talking about this movie. Yeah.
Sorry. How dare you? We give extreme opinions on this. I don't know, it's not bad. Once again, it's not a bad thing. I just, it's there. It's okay. It's all right.
For me, when, like I said, it's very immersive. It's got enough sweetness, enough like spice pepper thing going on. That just keeps me engaged all the way through it. Like, this to me, for my palate, it's always been like a box worthy cigar. Like, I could see myself getting a box of this. It's just, it's great.
Now I will say, Coleman, that I do prefer the Maduro on this, and maybe that would be more up your alley as well.
I don't think
it's quite a throat punch the way that some Maduros can be. Take that as it is.
I think what we're going to need to do is the sampler pack for April coming up. We'll have to put the Maduro version in there. Compare and contrast. So for me, the cigar, I would say on a scale from 1 to 10, easily is an 8.5 for me. I feel like I look for this type of profile. I would agree. The Maduro, I think I like a little bit better, but the Claro has so much to offer still that it's up there. So good for me.
I mean, I'm in the same boat too, and it's not just the flavor component, but you know, I very extremely rarely have any smoking issues, burn issues, whatever you want to call it, with Foundation. You know,
yes.
On top of everything else, it's just well constructed. You know, the smoke output is great, and all of that stuff. It's like the foundation that you need for like an enjoyable smoke. You know,
yeah.
So
I agree. Yeah. It's reliable. Coleman, what about you? Yeah. Where's your rating?
I'd give it like a 7.58. Like it's okay. You know, just it's good. It's stable. I like I said, I want to smoke it again because I'm wondering if I got like one that's not fully there. I'm wondering.
Okay. Okay. Well, and it was, I don't know, in the mailbox for 2 days, so that
might no one else needs to know.
So as we come to the rating for Patton, let's start with Coleman. Where do you think this ends on the scale from 1 to 10 for you?
I'd probably give it, I don't know, probably like a 6.57. It's okay. It's one of those where it's like I'm sorry, Curtis. Mind you, okay.
Don't always agree.
Hold up. All right. Look. For my personal rating,
I'll give it a 6.57.
For like objective, I would put it more probably in the 8. I don't know what its competition was, but I don't know if it was best picture material, but it also, after watching it, I see why it won best picture. Like it's one of those you just kind of watch and go, oh yeah, this is a, you know, they're trying to get best picture. You know, it had that type of feel to it to me.
Okay. So. Yeah.
But yeah, all in all, I think I'd watch it again. Like, I don't think I'd never watch it again. I would watch it definitely with a different mindset going in. Like, I would.
There is an intermission in this one, so you could break it up if you wanted to.
That's true.
Yeah, when I saw intermission, I was like, oh no. that means there's more. Like, a lot more.
So, I think for me, yeah, my rating, like Coleman says, doesn't reflect it being a bad or good movie. I think objectively, if you watch how this movie's made, I think it's a good movie. For me personally, I would probably say probably a 6 out of 10. For the reasons I stated, I hope I don't have to watch it again. I'll say that. But I also, just as a caveat, I remember we rewind the clocks to October, and I suggested No One Will Save You. And I know anyone who hasn't heard that episode, go back and listen to that episode. But I fully went into that episode thinking like, Coleman and Curtis are probably going to dig this movie. I really, really like it. And then you guys are like,
it's hot garbage.
And I was like, what? Like,
it's hot garbage.
So Curtis, I'm trying not to throw too much shade on it. It's just, I don't think it's the flavor of film for me.
Extreme opinions, Eric. Extreme opinions.
That's right.
Yeah.
I'm shocked.
Hot garbage. I love this movie. It's a 9 for me. You know, part of it is probably just a personal affinity for 70s script writing and the way that they have lots of moral ambiguity in them and, you know, kind of use history to comment on the present and stuff like that, I think is really fascinating. I think George C. Scott is like monumentally excellent in this movie. It's hard for me to picture anybody else doing it.
John Wayne.
No, John Wayne would not have done a good job.
We gotta go get those.
John Wayne doesn't have
exactly.
Enough, John Wayne doesn't have enough subtlety for this. You know, even things we didn't mention, Jerry Goldsmith's score, which sounds like it's a you know, the theme sounds like it's plucked straight from, you know, the, you know, late 18th, early 19th century, but it's original music. And, you know, yeah. And okay. You know, but then there's that kind of, there's that little echoey trumpet that gives just like a hint of like uncertainty or, you know, I don't want to say danger, but like, you know, it's not completely settled, you know,
yeah.
The main theme sounds triumphant, but it's surrounded by stuff that kind of unsettles
it a little bit. Which reflects Patton's character.
Perfect. Yes, exactly. Yeah. So, yeah, I like all the gears that this film is cooking on, and I reserve, you know, a 9 out of 10 because it's kind of hard to say that a movie is perfect, and you know, putting a 10 on something is a little weird, but I adore it to pieces.
Okay. Now, really quick, I wanted to say I agree with you when you say in the 1970s and like the moral ambiguity and how they use historical figures and such in their storytelling. The one thing I will say though about that era, like early 60s to like late 70s, is they can never, when they're doing a historical fiction like piece, they can never get the hair and the makeup right.
Oh,
it always looks like the 70s in the 40s. Like I'm always like The Sting, great movie, and we should eventually do that one. I haven't seen that forever, but I just remember watching it being like, so this movie's in the 70s, like just because it just doesn't. Yeah, so that's my one complaint
about it. Does happen, that's true.
Yeah. Peter is saying, can you imagine John Wayne doing French lines?
Oh no.
I don't think Schaffner could either. So I was trying to remember, I think the other person they were considering was Burt Lancaster, I believe.
Oh, that could have been interesting.
So yeah. It's funny too, on that kind of like note of what could have been, I was listening to like a making of thing with Lord of the Rings because it's all consuming our family right now. Yeah. And they were saying that potentially Aragorn's character was like being thought for, who was it? Russell Crowe was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And Nicolas Cage was another one. Like,
they had actually hired a different actor and shot for a couple of
weeks.
But he wasn't working. So Viggo came out of the movie late, but there was somebody else originally cast to play Aragorn.
Crazy. Yeah. This is funny. Yeah, not even Star Wars escaped the 70s. Luke's haircut is straight out of the 70s. Awesome. Okay, so next week is our final in the stride of Best Pictures is our final, and this one's my pick.
Yeah.
And I will say I'm not picking this movie because I love it, but I think it will be an interesting conversation. We are going to be tackling Gladiator, starring Russell Crowe. And what was that, 2000? And
Best Picture for 2000. So
2000. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you guys have seen that movie, get ready to talk about Gladiator. If you've not, go back, watch it, such like that.
Hey, guys, by the way, that was 24 years ago. Just chew on that.
Don't remind me, man. It's scary.
It's crazy.
I think about it like that. Jeez.
24 years ago.
The turn of the century.
Did any of you guys see it in the theater when it came out?
I did.
No.
Okay.
I was. Yeah. I was going to say, I think I was 10 or 12. I was 12. So. Yeah, cool. No, I didn't see. I don't think I saw that one until a couple of years after. I think I remember seeing it at my Aunt Cindy's house. Yeah.
So Peter's saying, yes, great pick. No need to be rude. I probably won't get to that point, but you know. But no, thank you guys for joining on Cinema Cigars and Cinema Podcast Live. Coleman and Curtis, thank you for jumping on. We will try to execute next episode official titles for everybody.
You gotta let them come naturally.
Well, okay. Well, then I'll give you titles and then we'll go from there.
By the way, I just want to say I appreciate both of you guys being willing to going a little far afield and, you know, watch a 3 hour long 70s movie that, a lot of people our age have probably maybe not even heard of. So it's appreciated.
Well, no, it's honestly been on the list for some time. So many people at the shop talk about it. I'm like, I got to watch that. And I eventually some of those like titles on my list, I'm like, we'll get to it in Cigars and Cinema Podcast. I'll watch
there
it.
You go.
It's enjoying to me to give a fresh take in terms of a movie I've never seen. Sometimes when it's a movie we're discussing, I've seen like 10 times, and I'm like, well, here you go. But but awesome. All right, everyone, have a great night. We will see you next Tuesday, 7:35 p.m. Pacific State.